Well, hello there! In this video, I hope to give a brief overview of our scientific understanding of embarrassment and cringe, which, as you may have guessed, isn't the most scientific of terms. You might call it vicarious embarrassment. It's
Friday, gotta get down on Friday. I mean, you're lucky you only got battery.
Cringe is obviously subjective, but I think most people know it when they see it. And with the proliferation of social media, there are more easy to access examples of cringe than ever. And cringe is very popular. Reels and reels of people making fools of themselves, catalogued and uploaded for mass consumption. But why are we drawn to it?
When I grew up, the solar system was stationary.
All right,
honey,
come on.
The sun was standing.
Why don't you stop this bullshit? Idiot.
To first understand cringe, or vicarious embarrassment, the proverbial and possibly literal clenching of your butt cheeks after someone calls the science teacher mom, we have to understand embarrassment. That may sound easy, we all know what embarrassment is, but it's very difficult to come up with a scientific definition that truly takes into account the many variables that contribute towards these, or really any, feelings. Embarrassment has been broadly classified as a self-conscious emotion, but whether it is totally distinct from other emotions, such as guilt or shame, is up for debate. Lines between embarrassment, guilt, and shame are inevitably blurry, as, of course, people do experience several emotions all at once that they themselves may have difficulty distinguishing. For example, you could be happy, but also a bit nervous. You could be melancholic, but also a bit horny. Endless combinations. Before neuroscientists were able to image parts of the brain in action, it was once theorized that feelings of embarrassment originated from the fear of being negatively evaluated by other people, and not oneself. Which to me is kind of odd. There were no neuroscientists who ever tripped on a banana skin or unwittingly sat on a cake, out of view of anyone else, and thought to themselves, "Phew, I'm glad no one saw that." But the reason they believed this was that it was theorized embarrassment was a necessary fear response to not being accepted by a group or community, and that it evolved to fill this role. Now, with decades of study, we know that embarrassment, and the entirety of the human emotional spectrum, its influences and how it affects actions, are multi-layered and complex. What you might feel embarrassed about is different to what I might feel embarrassed about. It is personal and cultural. In some predominantly Muslim countries, it might be considered rude or ignorant to offer your left hand for a handshake or use it to eat food. But people elsewhere would likely not find doing so to be embarrassing or in any way out of the ordinary. And me personally, I come from a tiny backwater cave where playing music loudly on public transport is a capital offence, but everyone else in the world loves it. So the social norms that govern what could be considered embarrassing are obviously very varied. A person might make moral judgments based strongly on their own cultural identity, or it could be much more personal than that. It's this moral judgment, along with humans' ability to self-evaluate, that is now believed to be the driver for feeling embarrassment. Our ability to self-evaluate has likely been with us for a long time, certainly before we started cooking our food or wearing socks and sandals. Like feelings of jealousy and envy, this ability to evaluate ourselves is probably one of many core parts of our survival instincts. During various studies where volunteers' brain activity was monitored as they were subjected to different forms of media, researchers found the superior temporal sulcus, the STS, to be engaged during, and only during, depictions of social activity, regardless of the social activity being displayed. Two people having a chat, the STS is active. two lemons being brutally crushed by an industrial press, inactive. Two people hitting each other with lemons, active. Research also suggests that people with autism may have less activity on the right side of the superior temporal sulcus. And so, it seems likely that the STS is responsible for taking information from several places, auditory, ocular, memory, and more, and collating it into our emotional perceptions, as well as being involved in general social cognition. One particular study, seen here, authored by Muller, Pinsler et al., attempted to isolate the primary drivers of embarrassment, the violation of a norm, and the fear of negative evaluation. Essentially, what they did was have people answer questions, and then they would tell them they performed okay, very well, or very poorly, regardless of how they actually performed, in front of a small group. At the same time, a control group were told their results without the group in front of them, allowing the researchers to separate the effect of having an audience from the effect of performing well or not. With the people given their results in front of a group, the brain ticklers found that the anterior insula was very active both during very good and very bad ratings, but not when given neutral ratings. Essentially, it was active when people felt pride or embarrassment. They found that the anterior insula was active when performances were rated very high or very low, but not when people were given neutral ratings or very high or very low ratings in private. Because very good performance corresponded with high pride ratings and low performance with high embarrassment ratings, the researchers suspect that this anterior insula activity may in some way be linked to the entire range of self-conscious emotions. That study concludes the converging integration of information from mentalizing areas and arousal processing systems within the ventral anterior insula and amygdala forms the neural pathways of embarrassment.
May I go to my room, sir?
Denied! Sit down!
The interaction between the amygdala, often called the emotional center of the brain, and the anterior insula, when someone experiences someone else's pain, has been well established. So this suggests that whenever you see someone get hurt and think, oof, similar things occur in your brain when you feel embarrassed for someone else. Maybe not the exact same neuro interaction, but very similar. Personal embarrassment, and the feelings of embarrassment for the actions or failures of others, sometimes called Fremdschämen by German speakers, likely is an expression of empathy. Even if the person you feel embarrassed for doesn't feel embarrassed at all, you know that if that was you, you'd feel very embarrassed. Important to note is that feelings of empathy for the embarrassed person does not necessarily mean you have to like them. There's plenty of fiction out there that is all about vicarious embarrassment. Fremdschämen and Schadenfreude are empathetic reactions. For example, for me personally, in Curb Your Enthusiasm, Larry David's actions are sometimes a bit justifiable, sometimes not at all, but I always feel the same cringing agony. I empathize with the embarrassment, even if I don't sympathize with the person causing or suffering it, whether he brought it on himself or not. Whether it be fiction or real, even if the subject is a total sausage, I would guess that a broad feeling of, I'm glad I'm not them, or I'm glad I'm not in that situation, is near universal, more so than poor them. I wonder if there is a weird combination that draws people to cringe content of, I'm glad that's not me, I'm not such a weirdo after all, but also, not always, a feeling of moral superiority when it comes to people being deliberately or needlessly cringy. There is surely an undeniable connection with hate watching, but not always. It depends on the consumer's or the audience's own moral perspectives, and probably no small part on how they're feeling that day. Is the cringe reaction good or bad for our own well-being? Well, It depends on the situation. But it is natural. So there you go. The next time you find yourself cringing at a video of someone defecating their pants in public, it's because you're an empathetic person. Who knew? Thanks for watching the video. You can support me on Patreon. You can support me on PayPal, where you could buy me a bean. How cringe! Thanks for watching. Cheerio. Leave!